I think, and I think I said as sincerely as I could, the vast majority of the people in our country are not racist, they're not prejudiced, and they don't believe in discrimination. The problem in many instances is they have to have the opportunity to meet and to understand and to know those candidates. And it's our job to extract from those people that fairness that I know they have.
We look forward to hearing your decision this summer. Do you know where you'll make the announcement?
No, I don't know where I'll make it, but I can assure you, you'll be one of the first to know.
Governor Douglas Wilder, our guest this evening, Democratic Governor from Virginia, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you so much. Always good to be with you.
We'll be back in just a few moments. Our program will continue as the topic turns to a look back at the Persian Gulf War.
For more information, call the National Captioning Institute at 1-800-533-9673. The top news stories are reviewed at the end of each week by journalists and C-SPAN viewers. Tune in as we re-air the Journalist Roundtable Viewer Call-In Program, Saturdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Time, 6 p.m. on the West Coast. Sunday nights, tune to C-SPAN for Book Notes, an hour of conversation with the authors of today's top political, historical, and public policy books. Topics include current events, issues in the news, and biographies of leading historical figures. Book Notes, every Sunday beginning at 8 and 11 p.m. Eastern Time, only on C-SPAN.
Watch the day's top news story unfold. Event of the day on C-SPAN. Whether it's an important press conference, a congressional hearing, or a White House briefing that makes headlines, tune in for a first-hand look at the news events that might impact you tomorrow. Weeknights at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, 5 p.m. Pacific. Only on C-SPAN.
From the halls of Parliament in London, England, C-SPAN brings you the British House of Commons, and with it, common sense. For an inside look at the proceedings of England's Legislative Congress, Common Sense provides you with an overview of the powers of Parliament and examines the role of the Queen. You'll discover what members do in a typical day, how a bill becomes a law, and the history of television coverage in the chambers. Common Sense also gives you a handy guide to terms, a valuable reference. To order your copy, send a check or money order for $3 to C-SPAN Common Sense, 400 North Capitol Street, Suite 650, Washington, D.C., 20001. C-SPAN is the cable television industry's public affairs network. Since 1979, C-SPAN has provided audiences an inside look at the democratic process. If you have a comment about our network, please write. Our address is C-SPAN, 400 North Capitol Street Northwest, Suite 650, Washington, D.C., 20001.
Up next, a discussion about conscientious objector status and how it's achieved. The program will include a look at the history of dissent and the status of COs in the Persian Gulf War. Our guests are John Judge, a counselor with the Draft and Military Project, and Charles Maresca, staff attorney with the National Interreligious Service Board for Conscientious Objectors. Thank you.
Charles Maresca, staff attorney for the National Interreligious Service Board for Conscientious Objectors. How did the recent war in the Persian Gulf change the treatment of issues around conscientious objectors?
Well, we found that the way that conscientious objectors were treated during the war was a lot harsher than it had been previously. The conscientious objectors who were called up, especially out of the reserves, were treated very harshly. Many of them found themselves in jail. They had to, some of them felt they had to refuse orders, and they are still being court-martialed. There are many who never had their claims processed, and many who are still waiting to hear whether they're going to be discharged honorably as conscientious objectors or discharged criminally as people who broke the law.
Why do you think this change happened that you perceive?
Well, the biggest problem was that there was a change in the procedures, first of all. In previous times, conscientious objectors who put in a claim would not be required to proceed to a new duty station as long as they didn't have orders already when they put in their claim. These people who were called up out of the reserves put in their claims immediately to be discharged as conscientious objectors. Later on, when their units were ordered to deploy to the Gulf, they were ordered as well to deploy. That's a very big change and something that we hadn't really anticipated.
John Judge, pre-enlistment, active duty, and reserve counselor for the Draft and Military Project. How has the issue of conscientious objectors changed over time?
Well, I think that who can be a conscientious objector legally has actually broadened over the years since, say, the World War I period, mm-hmm. especially with legal cases that came to bear in Supreme Court during the Vietnam period. Objectors who were atheists or agnostics who didn't follow a traditional religious belief, much less a peace church membership, were allowed legal status. And another major change was that people in the armed forces who had previously only been allowed legal alternatives of non-combatant duty were allowed a discharge from the military as well if that was the nature of their belief. And so it affected larger numbers of people. Many, many more people began to apply, especially during the Vietnam period, as conscientious objectors. And the definition of who could be one allowed a much broader range. One example of that is Cassius Clay, for instance. Muhammad Ali, the boxer who applied during those years as a Muslim. And no one expected at the time he went in the Supreme Court that he would win the case, but in fact, he did win. And the conception of who could be an objector, I think, has really reached out to a much broader level of the society.
I don't know if you know this. Have the numbers changed drastically over the years? How many people legally are?
Well, the numbers go up and down depending on whether or not the military is actively involved in combat, mm-hmm. as you can imagine, because what the military law requires is that the belief hardens into an objection at some point after people go into the military. And so while they had numbers perhaps in the hundreds during the volunteer military period up till the Persian Gulf conflict, the numbers leapt up to thousands of people that applied just in about 6 month period after August when the hostilities actually began. There are levels right now that we haven't seen since the height of the resistance to the war in Vietnam and objectors at that level.
If you're joining us live on this Friday evening, you may have seen earlier in the day a special series of programs produced by C-SPAN in which we showed you some people from the 211th Military Police Company from Clyde and Asheville, North Carolina. This was the group that C-SPAN went to the Persian Gulf with during the war, and as they came home recently, we showed you this afternoon that coming home and some discussions around that. Tonight, our topic turns to something else about the look back at the Persian Gulf War, and that is the issue of conscientious objectors. Joining us this evening are Charles Maresca, Jr. He is a staff attorney for the National Interreligious Service Board for Conscientious Objectors. What is that?
This is an association of the churches. It was formed in 1940 to assist conscientious objectors in obtaining recognition from the government that they couldn't perform military service for the upcoming World War II draft. It subsequently administered the civilian public service camps during World War II. and since then has offered advice, counsel, and assistance to conscientious objectors facing the draft and those who find themselves in military service seeking discharge.
And your job as staff attorney is what?
As staff attorney, I direct the counseling program, which means anybody who comes to us for assistance with a discharge will get it from me generally. We also offer assistance to attorneys who are representing conscientious objectors in court cases. We also offer testimony to Congress and conduct some negotiations with federal agencies that have some concern for conscientious objectors.
How is your organization funded?
We're funded by the churches and by individual donations.
Also joining us this evening is John Judge. He is a pre-enlistment, active duty, and reserve counselor for the Draft and Military Project. What is that, Mr. Judge?
Well, Draft and Military Project is a local D.C. area counseling group. We're one of perhaps scores of such local counseling groups that exist across the country who assist young people in making what are often uninformed or difficult decisions about registering for the draft, about enlistment into the ranks of the military, and once in, about problems that they're having there, legal problems and discharge questions. We also do referral work with veterans from the Vietnam period forward.
And how are you funded?
We're funded primarily by individual donations and fundraising activities.
When a person comes to you for counseling, are there patterns of the types of questions or the types of needs that a person has, or is it really very individualistic?
Well, a person comes with a whole set of individual problems, a part of which are usually interacting with their military status. I don't think there's any way to characterize sort of a typical counselee, mm-hmm. but I think they are people who, in general, due to the nature of their experience with the military at whatever level, whether it's thinking about joining in the first place or already in, have become disillusioned, have had promises broken. The things they most commonly complain about are that recruiters have misrepresented the situation to them, that they have family hardships and problems that the military is ignoring, that their personal medical problems aren't being dealt with, or that they have other changes in their life that make it difficult for them to go forward. Or we see a lot of people who run afoul of the Uniform Code of Military Justice and the military justice system, which is a unique, separate judicial system within the ranks of the military. We're actually the last Western nation in the world with an internal military judicial system like this. And it's basically a few steps above the old Prussian order, sort of line officer justice. And it can lead to anything from a non-judicial punishment where you just go and take your knocks from an officer. It doesn't include confinement, could be a fine and bust in rank, to formal courts martial and less than honorable discharges and long-term confinements, which many of these people are facing now because they would not deploy into a combat zone.
In about 5 minutes, we'll start taking your phone calls this evening, as we would invite you to join us. You'll see phone numbers at the bottom of your screen if you have a question or comment for our guest this evening. And again, that'll be in just about 5 minutes. First of all, we need to step back and maybe get a little bit of history about how this came about. Under what law is conscientious objectors? What does that come under?
Well, the law generally that gets referred to that offers the definition is the Military Selective Service Act. It contains a definition of who is a conscientious objector, what the legal standard is that a conscientious objector must meet in order to be recognized as a conscientious.
What does that law say in terms of a definition of a conscientious objector?
It says that you have to have deeply held beliefs. They can be religious, moral, or ethical in nature, or some combination of that. They have to be deeply held, and they have to leave you personally opposed to participating in war in any form. And that's generally been interpreted to mean any war that's available to you, you have to have a personal objection to your participation in order to be qualified as a conscientious objector. The military services, every one of the branches has written into their own regulations a recognition that conscientious objectors under that standard will be discharged.
And how does the law determine deeply, the deeply held feelings?
Well, the law doesn't really say that. The Code of Federal Regulations outlines procedures that all of the military services do follow, and that is a series of interviews. It's a fairly rigorous procedure. You go through an interview with a psychiatrist, an interview with a chaplain, and an investigating officer hearing, at which time the conscientious objector, who has already submitted a fairly extensive statement of what his or her beliefs are, and any supporting statements by people who might appear as witnesses, as well as others who wouldn't appear, all of that is investigated by the investigating officer. The conscientious objector must submit to questioning. He may or may not be represented by counsel. Most are not when they go through this hearing. The investigating officer makes a recommendation. The commanding officer of the individual makes a recommendation. The staff lawyers of the branch will make a recommendation. The convening authority of that branch will make a recommendation. And it all goes to department headquarters, where they review the record and make a determination. It takes a long time.
Like how long?
Well, recently it's been taking at the least 9 months, and it's been taking more than that for a lot of the people who are called up.
And during this time, what happens to the person who has filed the claim?
In the meantime, they are supposed to be given orders that offer as little conflict as possible with their stated beliefs. That's not possible for those who deployed to the Gulf. Those people are being told, well, in the meantime, you're going to have to go to the war in order to wait out the decision on whether you object to going to the war. It's a real problem for those folks.
Is the process fair?
Well, the process is to me sort of antiquated and doesn't really, I mean, the fact that you have to go see a psychiatrist, for instance, indicates that the military is already biased in terms of its evaluation of why someone would become a conscientious objector. And we found in the recent psychiatric interviews that they began to introduce testing tools like the MMPI, Minnesota Multiphasic Tests, and were asking conscientious objectors to sign release forms so the military could study the results of those tests, which I feel was an attempt of the military to try to diagnose a profile of who would be likely to become a conscientious objector, how to deal with them. And so I think just the fact that that is required, I don't think that the military is in any position to really determine the sincerity of the individual. If they might have some glaring contradiction, but in most cases, the officers who handle these cases are not familiar with the law or with the court cases that determine sincerity and what does or does not count as a reason to deny the claim. And they come up with a whole variety of reasons for saying the person isn't sincere, few of which have any basis either in fact or in law. We had a case here just recently of somebody who was turned down initially by his investigating officer on the grounds that he was a reservist, and he was in the individual ready reserve, and he worked as a security guard at the State Department. And his investigating officer felt that if he was able to carry a weapon or potentially use the weapon for deadly force, that automatically disqualified him from being a conscientious objector. In his rebuttal, we helped him put together case law that showed that was not a legal reason for denial, and eventually the commander at the base overturned the investigating officer's decision. But objectors often make their claims without understanding what's expected of them, what the law is, and face these investigating officers and are turned down. And when wartime comes, the turndown rate goes up to about 80-85%, whereas in peacetime you might have a 20-25% turndown.
Are there cases coming out of the Persian Gulf that are being decided during this time?
Are there court cases?
Court cases, meaning people who have filed for conscientious objectors that are currently going through the system?
There have not been any court cases as far as I can recall. John can correct me if there were any, but there have been court cases filed mm-hmm. on behalf of conscientious objectors. They have not gone through the court system yet. There was one case in Kansas in which the conscientious objector is challenging the order, the call-up order and the order to deploy. That hasn't gone anywhere yet.
There was a case in at Camp Lejeune in North Carolina.
Yes,
is that different?
Those are military courts.
Mm-hmm.
They're not federal courts.
They
won't establish any new precedent. These people are being prosecuted for missing movement. They're being charged with a very serious crime, which is missing movement to avoid hazardous duty, and they are being. Many of them are pleading guilty to lesser offenses simply to avoid the
In fact, two of them have been charged with desertion in time of war, which under the military law carries a maximum of a death penalty. And in one case, the government lawyer's brief, the military lawyers asked for the death penalty in a government brief. And these are for crimes of a short-term absence, usually with a voluntary return, which otherwise would be handled administratively, basically with a slap of the wrist. And they're tacking together these charges of desertion to avoid duty, and up to 7 to 11 years they're threatening them with brig time and confinement. So it's very, very harsh, severe treatment. Nothing that we've seen, even during the Vietnam period, the charges were not like this. And this is based on regulations that were promulgated outside of the Federal Register, and we feel, at least illegally so, by electronic transmittal.
Mr. Judge has been working on the staff of organizations like the Dayton Draft of Military Counseling, Central Committee for Conscientious Objectors in Philadelphia, the project that we talked about here in Washington, and others since 1965. Again, today he is a pre-enlistment, active duty, and reserve counselor for the Draft and Military Project. And also joining us this evening, Charles Maresca, Jr., staff attorney for the National Interreligious Service Board for Conscientious Objectors. He's been on staff there for 12 years and has served as staff attorney for that organization for the past 3 years. Let's go to the phones, gentlemen. Cliffside Park, New Jersey, you're first.
Yes, hello. I served in the military for 4 years myself, and before I went in, I was well aware that my primary duty would be, you know, to go to war, to serve, protect, and I was young at the time, but I knew that, you know, I was going in to do that, and I feel that if somebody joins the military, any branch, that they will be obligated to go to war. No matter what.
Reaction?
I think it's a commonly asked question, but I feel that the question is almost like asking someone who's petitioning for a divorce why they got married in the first place. Things change. And in fact, the military laws require that the belief becomes an objection or hardens into objection after entry into the military. If somebody was already a convinced pacifist, conscientious objector at the time they entered, their claim would not be considered under military regulations. The military allows for the fact that people come in often under what we call a volunteer military. The recruiters have used the promise of a peacetime military and told many recruits that they would never see combat as one of the recruiting tools. And while some people may feel in a vague way that there's some connection between the combat training they do at basic and real war, it's facing real war and facing actually killing somebody that usually brings someone to the kind of soul-searching or the questions that lead them to realize that they can't do it. And that's what these provisions are for. People that facing the reality of a battle, not just the abstract idea, find themselves incapable due to their beliefs, or their beliefs have changed. And many people join religions, peace churches, while they're in the military, and their beliefs alter.
Conscientious objection is also one of the better kept secrets in the military regulations. They don't lecture anybody in boot camp on how to get out. They pretty much keep that information away from them, especially information on how to get out as a conscientious objector. We've had many people come to us who said they initially had their misgivings in boot camp.
Well, George, I'm sorry.
These people also find it hard to get hold of the regulations, even when they ask about conscientious objection there. Discouraged from doing so.
Clovis, Georgia, go ahead. Georgia, are you there? I'm sorry, they hung up. Let's try again. Good evening, caller. Where are you calling from?
Coatesville, Pennsylvania.
You are on the air. Go ahead.
Hello?
You're on the air. Go ahead with your question, sir.
Oh, thank you. I just had two comments.
Mm-hmm.
One was that in the Army, when I was in, about 80% of the Army is support services. So there's only 20% that are actually considered combat arms. And the other thing I had was during the Gulf War, I noticed that, for instance, there was a doctor who got a lot of national publicity. She'd been in the reserves for several years and all of a sudden turned around and became a conscientious objector. You know, how do you handle something like that? I really personally don't believe that's right. If you're taking the money, you know what you're supposed to do.
I think people take the money for real work that they do, and if you put real military pay against the hours worked, they don't get very much more than a minimum wage from it. The benefits touted by the recruiters and the military and the ads are not really that great, And since one out of every 10 people that goes in the military ends up with a less than honorable discharge, most of them can't even collect the GI Bill benefits. I think that these provisions are there because there's a constitutional idea that people have a right to religious beliefs, and that those beliefs are not to be stepped on by the state or dictated by the state. And that's why I think you have to make provisions for somebody who, as he says, turns around, and these regulations are written, I feel, to encounter that situation. It is true that many people in the military work in support rather than direct combat services, and it is possible to make a claim as a conscientious objector if you feel you can do that work and say that your beliefs only keep you from combat, and you'll just be reassigned to non-combatant duties, although that might include working in a combat zone, but you'd be there without a weapon. Other people feel that any work in the military exposes them to a contradiction, that they're part of a support service. The field manual, for instance, for medics in the Army specifies that the purpose of the medicing is to make the troops mobile and to get the injured and the dead out of the way so that the troops can move and be more efficient in battle. And so many people feel that support services or wearing the uniform or being part of an organization with that as its goal is a violation of their conscience. And I think people's conscience has to be respected.
Difference between reserves and active, does it make a difference in terms of filing, how many, what?
It makes a difference when there's no war going on. There's an active duty person can file at any time and will be processed pretty much where he is. The reservist is further removed, mentally at least, and certainly physically from having to do any weapons training or carry any weapons. These are things that they cannot do in good conscience, they don't have to face the question as often as the active duty person. They just don't have it staring them in the face. And so very many of them put off the question. As a matter of fact, we have had cases where people accepted transfers into the reserves from active duty to avoid the long, arduous process of getting a CO discharge, only to find out when the call-ups came that they were back where they started and they were no better off than they had been.
Rock Springs, Wyoming.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine, thanks.
I spent my time in the United States Navy in the submarine service, and it was my experience aboard the boat that most of the UCMJ codes and disciplinary actions against all the, well, we call them jelly brains, were more than fair to the people that were brought up against military justice. I had no disbelief. I thought it was really a fair code of ethics. It had a lot of latitude. The CO had a lot of latitude in what measures he could take against an individual. And I was just wondering where all the, maybe there is some people in a different branch that got unfair treatment, but it wasn't my experience.
You didn't see it.
Well, you're talking about a court-martial system that has a 95% to 98% conviction rate. You're talking about a system where basically everyone in the courtroom, from the jury to your lawyer and the prosecutor and the judge, are all working for the same company you are, and have to keep working there after they're done. And the most common crimes in the military are not crimes in the civilian world, like talking back to the boss is disrespect of an officer in the military. Walking off the job is a crime of absence in the military, and they can carry stiff penalties, whereas in the civilian world they wouldn't. So I think if any corporation had this level of disciplinary action against its employees, that somebody would begin to see that there was something wrong with the corporation. And I don't think the justice is uniform. It's called a uniform code of military justice, but I think it's very clear that they're treating short-term AWOLs who didn't file as conscientious objectors right now much differently than the people that did. And racial discrimination, I think, is throughout the military justice system. Even with their own studies, they admit that people of color are three times as likely to get court-martialed as whites, and more than half of the prison population in the military are African American or black people.
On paper, some of these procedures do seem fair. The process of a conscientious objector discharge was created in order to parallel what happened to those facing the draft in the 60s. And if you look at the two processes on paper, they look about the same. It seems fair. The problem is they're not ever administered in the way that they were written. The Code of Federal Regulations says this process should take 90 days. It takes 3, 4, 5 times that.
The caller said maybe it's different in other branches. Is there a difference within the branches in terms of not necessarily the law, but how it's administered?
You find differences from base to base, but I don't find that much difference from one branch to the other.
There's a difference between officers and enlisted, and some branches are more sort of top-heavy with brass than others, like Air Force. Officers even get separate treatment in their cells, like they'd have a TV was enlisted wouldn't, or they'd have a private cell where this enlisted would be. So they're treated differently throughout.
Granville, Michigan, you're next. Good evening.
Good evening. My name's Tom, and I'm a retired Chief Hospital Corpsman, United States Navy, and I'm a Vietnam vet. And first a comment. Number one, I'd like to inform the nation who's watching that as a hospital corpsman with the Marines, I was assigned a weapon, a 45. I could pick other ones, and I could carry that. And that was only for the defense of my own life and the life of my patient. That's very important to remember, mine and my patient. Now, my question is, with these people who are conscientious objectors, why can't they be assigned to the medical sections of either the Army or the Navy? I don't know what the Army does. I know what the Navy does. And see, sure, they're given a weapon. They can choose to use it or not. That would be their choice. But then they would be in a medical process. They would be assisting wounded people, and yet they would have the weapon in case they had to defend themselves. But this way, like, they would be able to serve their country, and they're already getting bucks from Uncle Sam anyway because they were in the reserves.
Okay, thanks, Michigan. Mr. Judge talked about this earlier. Any thoughts of yours?
They have that option. It's very true that they can ask for a designation as a noncombatant. It's not true that they can ask for designation as a hospital corpsman or as a chaplain's assistant. Their lives pretty much remain in the hands of their superiors. They are not guaranteed any particular spot, although if they get one, they probably stay there. There's, for the most part, most conscientious objectors say any part of the military is part of war making, and I can't do it.
San Diego.
Yes, how you doing? I'm
fine.
Active duty Marine Corps, and I've got a question. Number one, the individuals who are pending judicial action, did they claim conscientious objective prior to joining the service? Also, as compounded with a comment on John's, all articles of UCMJ are available at all libraries of military installations. All they need to do is just go on their own free time and find that. And to end up with you, and thank you for your time, a little comment that was made to me that was written by one of my friends. I may not agree with what you have to say, but I will defend your right to say it.
Mr. Judge?
Well, people might be able to go to a base library and be able to look at and understand the Uniform Code of Military Justice. The official posters, though, the Defense Department puts out only list up to Article 134. Article 138, for instance, is an important article that was added on to allow enlisted people to charge officers for failing to redress grievances that they have. And that article is very rarely explained to them. The reviews of the UCMJ are generally to tell them not to go AWOL and to threaten them with other sorts of treatment. These people were not conscientious objectors before they entered the military. As I mentioned before, it would discount their claim. They filed once they were in. Initially, they were not allowed to even hand in their claims. The Army changed that policy sometime in January. Then they began to take their claims and did some processing, but at the same time they trained them and began to deploy them to the Gulf. So some of them refused orders to train with weapons or do combat-related training. Others went absent for a short period rather than be deployed. But these are not aggravated or circumstances or crimes that normally would be handled in any harsh way. And we have asked for both congressional investigation, and 32 Catholic bishops have called for an amnesty in these cases, a dropping of the charges. the Amnesty International has declared two of these individuals, after looking at the cases, as prisoners of conscience within the United States. In the Briggs, there's a statement recently from about 25 other religious leaders supporting these people and asking for the charges to be dropped. And I find it interesting that the Iraqi government gave an amnesty to those who refused, but we are still lagging behind.
We have had some experience with some reasonable commanders who, when they were faced with reservists who were called up, who said they were conscientious objectors, gave them a short amount of time to make some initial showing that they were conscientious objectors, and then they were left behind to process their claim, and if their claim was denied, then they'd proceed to the Gulf. It seemed to me like that would have been a reasonable solution to the whole problem. But it was not a solution that was very popular among military people.
Biloxi, Mississippi.
Hi, yes. First of all, I'd like to say that I enjoy your program, but I disagree with some of the situations we're put in here. First of all, we're put in a situation where we have two experts on one side dealing with conscientious objectors, where we have no experts on the other side to rebut that. I'm in the military myself. I'm a paralegal. I believe in the conscientious objector program. I very strongly believe in that, but not when it comes to wartime. Now, the gentleman on the left, and on my left, and that's Mr. Judge, I believe it was, used a couple of terms that really angered me in such a way. He said the turndown rate during wartime was 80 to 85%. Now, you got to look at the other side of that. 80 to 85% during wartime, but yet during peacetime, you don't have near as many applicants because everything's going along. It's all well and good. And then when they're faced with the true reality of war, something they're paid to do, something they raise the right hand and they take an oath to do, they refuse all of a sudden to go to war. I feel that's wrong, and I don't agree with that. When their religious beliefs are involved, their intentions are good, by all means, go through the system, and I believe some of them are definitely put down for what they believe, and that's wrong to me. So I wanted to make that point, and facing reality is another term that he used. Yes, you're going to face reality, but I believe that a conscious person, if you're going to be a conscientious objector, when you raise your right hand, you must be a conscious person as well.
Mr. Judge?
Well, as I say, people change and their beliefs change. They raise their hands and take an oath to defend the Constitution and to defend the country. They're called into wars abroad that don't always clearly have much to do with that. And I didn't find much difference in my counseling experience, and maybe Charlie could say in his, between the people that came to us for help in the peacetime period who weren't being called to combat and the ones that are coming now. They seem as sincere to me. They seem to be based in similar types of religious or moral or ethical belief, but they're treated very differently by the military, in my experience.
Well, I think I agree with the caller in many respects. I notice that he does recognize that many of these people are being persecuted for their religious beliefs. The counselees that we have are very similar now. The difference is the what threw them into the decision of making a discharge application on the basis of conscience is that there was a war that they were being asked to participate in, and it is that hard reality that made the decision stand out in their minds as something that they must make and that they couldn't put off any longer.
Caller, you are correct that this the show in and of itself is not a balanced program, but you may have missed earlier we talked about some programs that we did earlier today in which we did a long focus on a specific military group, the 211th Military Police Company from Clyde and Asheville, North Carolina. This was the group that C-SPAN followed to the Persian Gulf, and then also earlier today we showed them as they were coming home with a lot of discussion with a variety of military personnel. That program will re-air on Memorial Day, on the 27th of May, 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time. And again, we, over a long period of time, try to bring a balance in our programs, and tonight we're spending our time talking about conscientious objectors. Ridgewood, New Jersey.
Yeah, currently I'm a recruiter on active duty with the United States Army. When an individual is approached by a recruiter and he begins filling out the contracts to enter into the military, there is a question on the contract that specifically asks about him being a conscientious objector.
What does the question say, caller?
if an individual has had an opportunity several times to identify himself as a conscientious objector, both on the contract at initial enlistment and during the first 6 months of his enlistment, doesn't that somewhat detract from his claim in the future of being a conscientious objector when he's asked to fulfill the job that he is enlisted for?
I'll go over it again. The military regulations state that someone who says they are a conscientious objector prior to or at the time of enlistment is not eligible to get discharged or reassigned as a conscientious objector once they're in the military. If young people knew what those two words meant, I didn't at age 17. I got a form from Selective Service that said, "Are you a conscientious objector?" I took it into my father. He said, "You're not one of those," and I put no. Had he explained to me what the two words meant, we would have probably had a debate about whether I was one, because I already knew at that age that I wasn't going to pick up a weapon or go to war. I didn't make any connection. I don't think most young people do. The caller must know that this is one in a series of questions that the people fill out. But if they said they were a conscientious objector, they wouldn't be eligible to enlist at that time. And when they don't, it doesn't disqualify them from becoming an objector later.
New Jersey, what's your reaction?
Well, the basic premise is an individual who is 17 or 18 years old, and I'm sure legal counsel there sitting there can verify this, does have the opportunity to revoke that contract if he determines that it's not in his best interest. A 17 or an 18 year old cannot enter into a contract because he is not considered to be competent enough to execute a contract. Now, chief legal counsel from your recruiting command has indicated to me that does hold true, and if an individual finds out at age 18 that he's entered into a contract which is not in his best interests, then he can approach his commander or his NCOs in his unit, and they will allow him to revoke that contract. Okay. Also, a 17-year-old's parents at any time up to the time that he is 18 years old can withdraw permission for him to serve in the military.
Thanks, New Jersey.
Well, his comment on the ability to revoke the contract, I can't say it's absolutely untrue, but it's very close. We've had any number of people who've entered into what's called a delayed entry program, which is the principal way that people sign up now to get into both the active duty and the reserves. And to convince a recruiter to tear up a DEP contract is very, very difficult. I just spent days and days on a case in which the recruit had gone through the whole CO process, and everybody agreed this was one genuine, 100% bona fide conscientious objector. They would not tear that contract up, and they never did.
They don't call it a contract, actually. It's called an enlistment agreement, and I think that's because legally a contract binds two parties, and the wording of this agreement is not very binding on the military. It's more binding on the individual, and there are a lot of loopholes in the agreement. It's also my experience that once people reach age 18 and ask for a discharge on this basis, that they're told that there's something called constructive enlistment. And the military will argue that if you took the pay and wore the uniform and followed the orders, you've constructively enlisted yourself into the military, even though it might not have been technically legal by your age at the time you went in. So I don't think it's just a matter of bringing it up to the command. Our experience is that in very few cases will they allow change, even where parents withdraw consent. They go out to recruit people, and they like to keep them.
Out to the West Coast, Sacramento.
Yes, C-SPAN?
Go ahead.
Thank you. I just want to make two fast points and say first that I believe that there's a difference now, especially between now and the past, that now we have an all-volunteer army. And I don't believe that a person who goes ahead and takes the pay should be able to file or be a conscientious objector. I believe that isn't the same case as when there was a draft. But let me say also that I believe that, or at least it's my belief, that once war comes and suddenly they do become conscientious objectors, I believe personally that those people are cowards. The only difference between them and another person, I bet most people are afraid to go to war, is that they choose not to do their duty, and other people choose to do their duty.
Well, there's a big difference now between now and the days of the draft. People who were conscientious objectors at the time that they were getting draft notices could tell Selective Service they were conscientious objectors. They could go through the Selective Service procedure of getting that classification. Those people are not signing up for the military. This is about the fifth or sixth time we've gone through this But the people who sign up for military service at some level want to do military service. They want the pay and they want the benefits, and they'll do the work that they need to do to earn that pay and benefit. If their beliefs change and they become conscientious objectors, they have the right under the regulations to apply for a discharge.
I would argue also that it is not an all-volunteer military, that it in fact relies on economic impressment, and it is a poverty draft that functions in many cases because young people have no other options or because they don't know of them. The delayed entry program catches them into an enlistment into the reserves in their junior year, usually before they've talked to a guidance counselor about their high college options or job options or other training that they could get, and they're already signed up and locked into a military agreement.
Americans' perceptions of conscientious objectors, what's your kind of feel for that? Has it changed?
I think it has. I think that Vietnam very much left a legacy of the idea that there's such a thing as a bad war, and I don't think this country had that idea before. And I think the amnesty that was granted afterward, the pardons and other things that have followed other wars, and the general social mood was much more supportive of the idea that there's also a right to say no to a bad war. And I think that what we'll see now in the modern age, when the weapons are so deadly, when the chance for nuclear war is so likely in a regional conflict, when you have situations where the percentage of civilian dead in war has climbed now to 85% or 90% in modern warfare, and the general communications are better and people know about their rights and about the law, that the number of conscientious objectors will increase, and that in fact the idea of a selective objector, a person who would participate in one war or not another, will eventually have a legal status.
There's virtually no denomination in this country that does not say that conscientious objection is a legitimate position that can be arrived at on the basis of our religious beliefs, of our religious tradition. There simply isn't a church left that says you can't be a conscientious objector.
Killeen, Texas.
Hello? Hello?
You're on the air.
Okay. I'd just like to make a statement. My statement is mostly that I feel if you are a conscientious objector after getting into the military, especially if you took like the GI Bill or the four-year scholarship program, that you should immediately be removed from the Army but be required to pay back all monies that you borrowed, especially since you didn't do your time. How do you feel about that? Either?
Most people are. If they're in ROTC, for example, they've taken scholarship money and they're not, and they are discharged as conscientious objectors. The military very often will ask them to pay back the scholarship. They don't get asked to pay back the pay that they earned while they were in. They don't pay certain other money that they received, but they very often are asked to pay those scholarships back.
The GI Bill is also based on earned pay being put in by the enlisted person, as well as additional pay from the military itself. And I think that it's fair for anyone who's put that in, if they end up with an honorable discharge under any situation, to get those GI benefits. When you are discharged less than honorably, you lose not only the extra money for the military, but the money that you've put in yourself. And I don't think that's fair. I think that money ought to be paid back to the enlisted.
Kingston, New York. Hello.
How you doing?
Fine.
One quick comment and a question. First of all, I agree with one of the other callers that called in and said basically that if you're already enlisted and then become a conscientious objector, you're a coward, or at least you're a hypocrite, okay, in changing your mind. But to the two gentlemen, you know, they're basically, when wars come along, when activities come along that they don't agree with, and then they encourage through their actions, through their advice, people who are serving to become conscientious objectors to suddenly change their hearts. Those people are going to suffer the consequences. These two guys here, you know, they'll go on with their talk shows or whatever. Or do they feel responsible in any way for what they're encouraging other people to do?
I've never had to encourage anybody to change their mind about their beliefs. People came to me for counseling because they weren't able to live with the situation they had in the military for a variety of reasons. I, in fact, would not suggest to somebody that they become a conscientious objector as a means to avoid service or even seek a discharge from the military. It's probably one of the roughest and lengthiest and most aggravating methods that somebody could use who wants to get out of the military service. So I've never had to change anybody's mind or proselytize on these issues. It's the nature of the military and the nature of war that lead people to become objectors.
the argument that there that conscientious objectors shouldn't be allowed out is an argument essentially with the military. The military really has an interest in getting people out of the ranks who aren't going to perform well as soldiers, and conscientious objectors really comes into that category. The argument is also with all of the social institutions, the churches and schools and education system. The people who become conscientious objectors, in my experience, are people of great depth, great sincerity, and the deprivations that they suffer and are suffering, especially now, are very severe and should not be inflicted on these people. They are simply conscientious objectors. They are not criminals. They are not supposed to be in jail. They ought not to be treated the way they are being treated.
How did you get into this area personally?
Well, personally, it was a matter of religious belief. It was during the Vietnam era when there was a lot of discussion of conscientious objection, a lot of discussion of in my tradition of just war, unjust war, how to evaluate, and it was a very personal decision on my part.
And you, Mr. Judge?
I, like many people in my generation, faced selective service system and realized fairly early on that I couldn't participate in war. I filed as a conscientious objector. I was turned down. I was sent to a physical and failed the physical. I started counseling in 1965 because I knew other people had these sorts of questions. I think the idea the caller makes, though, that if you file as a conscientious objector once in the military, you're automatically a coward is a silly one. I think that people's courage has to do with their convictions in whatever direction they are and living those convictions out. And it takes as much courage to take a stand like that, especially at wartime in a hostile environment, and to stand by it as it does to for someone who's frightened to pick up a weapon and go into the situation. There's fighting or not fighting, agreeing to carry a weapon or not, is not what makes bravery in an individual or cowardice.
Seattle, Washington. Hello.
Thank you. American Communist Party head Gus Hall was the backer of this group also. And what I would like to say, as a former National Guard man who was in the war, that any man or woman or person that takes this oath to honor and obey the United States Constitution and violates that oath knowing what they're taking, they know the oath, what they're taking at that time, and if they violate it, they should be prosecuted to every extent of the law possible. And the next, I was for hoping that there would have been a declaration of war against the Saddam Hussein socialist regime so that we could have a declaration of war and separate these people that are trying to undermine this country, such as these two men up here on the television are doing, to divide this country one against another.
Does the American Communist Party support your organization?
No, not visibly. You know, they may support the idea, as many organizations mm-hmm. do, that there's a right to conscience and conscientious objection, but you know, the idea that some submarine comes up the Potomac River and gives us money from Moscow dates back to the McCarthy period, I think.
And you, sir?
We don't get any of that kind of money.
Last call from St. Mary's, Ohio.
Yes, my comment is I spent 7 years in the military just recently during the Gulf conflict, mm-hmm. just recently got out. And I have no problems with conscientious objectors, even those that signed the contract, came in and decided later that they were a conscientious objector. But why wait until after a war starts and you're put in that situation where you have to deploy to make it convenient for you to draw all the pay and benefits possible and then file after a war starts because you don't want to go or you're scared to go or whatever? When I signed my contract along with everybody else, it said the Armed Forces of the United States of America. That's exactly what it is, Armed Forces. And the other comment that Mr. Judge made about the GI Bill, the soldiers should be returned their money that they have donated to that fund if they have a less than honorable discharge. If they're less than honorable, that just says that their service was not honorable. Their duty performance was less than adequate. Why return the money to them? They're not fulfilling their part of the obligation.
Okay, Ohio, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to let you go because we're kind of running out of time. Mr. Judge?
Money belongs to them. They saved it. I'm not suggesting you give them the additional funds that you would get from an honorable discharge, but if they put money aside, I don't think it's their money. They earned it. That shouldn't belong to the U.S. military. And, you know, I just think the attitude, you know, that somebody can only file a conscientious objector with a crystal ball, that thinking far ahead that they could see that perhaps the war would come and they wouldn't be part of it, is a luxury. And most people make those decisions when they cross the bridge of facing the possibility of going into a real war, and then inside themselves they find that they can't do it.
Mr. Maresca, you have the final word.
Well, why wait until war to be a conscientious objector? The answer is that's when conscientious objection means something. To be allowed to be a conscientious objector between wars is like being a vegetarian between meals. It only means something when there is an actual possibility of going to war to have that right to be discharged as a CO.
Joining us this evening, Charles Maresca, Jr., staff attorney for the National Interreligious Service Board for Conscientious Objectors, and John Judge, the pre-enlistment, active duty, and reserve counselor for the Draft and Military Project. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us this evening. Thanks to our viewers and our callers. Have a nice weekend.
Join us for Supreme Court Review this week for a look at the court's decision saying that regulations prohibiting federally funded clinics from dispensing abortion information are constitutional. The court voted 5-4 to allow the implementation of the rules that were first proposed in 1988. During the program, you will hear the comments of groups on both sides of the issue, including the American Civil Liberties Union, Planned Parenthood, the National Right to Life Committee, and Americans United for Life. That Supreme Court Review, Saturday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Good evening from the nation's capital. You're watching C-SPAN. We pause to check the schedule. First, a reminder to join us Wednesday morning at 8 Eastern Time for a live call-in. Our guest will be Marilyn Quayle. She chairs the International Disaster Advisory Board. Mrs. Quayle recently traveled to the cyclone-damaged regions of Bangladesh to participate in relief efforts there. She'll discuss her relief work in disaster areas both in the U.S. and around the world. Again, that live call-in program is Wednesday morning at 8 Eastern Time, 5 in the West. Our overnight programming begins in a few moments with today's State Department news briefing. Spokeswoman Margaret Tutwiler takes questions about a variety of issues, including developments in the Middle East and the insurrection in Ethiopia and the plight of 16,000 Jews in that country. After that, it's two speeches from the 21st Century Commission on African American Males meeting. That group has been holding its national conference to discuss a variety of issues. You'll hear from the Reverend Jesse Jackson and Dr. Louis Sullivan, Secretary of Health and Human Services. At about 9:40 p.m. Eastern Time this evening, highlights from this week's Dodd Washington Seminar and a panel discussion about the 1992 elections. Among those participating in the election outlook are Senate Minority Leader Robert Dole of Kansas and Virginia Democrat Charles Robb. After that, we rear a call-in program with a man who's considering running for the presidency next year, Governor Douglas Wilder of the Commonwealth of Virginia. The first black elected governor in the U.S., he spent 30 minutes with us earlier today talking about Democratic Party politics and his view of the presidency. Just past 11:30 p.m. Eastern Time, we rear the State Department news briefing. And after that, you will again see the speeches of the Reverend Jesse Jackson and HHS Secretary Dr. Louis Sullivan at the meeting of the 21st Century Commission on African American Males. Coming up at about 1:15 a.m. Eastern Time, it's debate from Friday's session of the Senate looking at fast-track legislation. The Senate concurred with the House in giving the President expedited procedures for negotiating trade agreements, and that would limit the role of Congress in adding amendments to them. 30 minutes with us earlier today talking about Democratic Party politics and his view of the presidency. Just past 11:30 p.m. Eastern Time.